Hi, good evening. So, welcome to our dialogue for the Homestretch. I would like to begin by introducing our speakers. So, when we think of films, we have this in mind, this sensationalized IMAX, big screen, Oscar-winning movies that allows us to escape the realities of life. But in fact, film also has this unique ability to raise social awareness on significant issues on everyday lives. Today we have veteran filmmakers who have documented an issue that has, up until now, little to no publicity and social awareness: youth homelessness in Chicago. This film not only touches on this matter, but significant issues on our society faces today. The struggles of the LGBTQ community, the foster care system, the school education system, and many more. Today, I had the unique opportunity with my peers to sit with our speakers and discuss their process in creating such an impactful film. They shared with us everything from the legal contract to finding the stories, but there was one important message I took away from them. Your career doesn't have to be one thing that you're passionate about. It can be an accumulation of passions and learned skills. For example, you can easily have an interest in politics and law alongside with the arts. And the most gratifying thing our speakers have felt from creating this film was being able to share such a story that means so much and can change the world. I'm honored to introduce them to you tonight. Elizabeth Hemmerdinger is the associate producer and writer of The Homestretch and has a number of notable films and plays like Elaine Strict Shoot Me and Squall. She also wrote and produced a short film that opened the Soho International Film Festival in May 2014 and was the official selection of the Boston International, New York Filmmakers, and Queens World Film Festival and received an award of excellence from Best Shorts. She also received the NYU Tisch School of Arts MFA Goldberg Prize for We Can Do It and is a member of the board of directors of the Women's Voices for Change. Laverne Barry is an entertainment lawyer and has been practicing for 13 years and has been an executive producer for a number of notable films. For example, the amazing film The Silent Truth, which I loved. She also has been named one of the New York Metro Area Super Lawyers in 2011, 13, 14, and 15 by Thomson Reuters, the top women's attorney in New York in 2014 and 15, and is the member of the New York Bar Association's Entertainment Law Committee and is former president of the Board of New York in Film and Television. Anne DeMar is an award-winning playwright, director, professional video artist, and filmmaker from New York City. She and her longtime film partner, Kristen Kelly, bring a unique storytelling sensibility of a theater background to their film work. Homestretch has been broadcasted nationally on the PBS award-winning series Independent Lens and was selected as part of the Traveling Human Rights Watch Film Festival and was invited to tour the American Film Showcase with the U.S. Department of State and will be screening this fall as part of the White House Initiative on Educational Excellence for African American Film Series. And Christine Kelly is an award-winning documentary film and theater director who is also an arts educator and director and co-creator of CPS Shakespeare, a highly acclaimed program that works with Chicago public high school students at the Chicago Shakespeare Theater, which was awarded the President's 2014 National Arts and Humanities Youth Program Award by Michelle Obama at the White House. Most recently, she has directed the critically acclaimed off-Broadway play, The Undeniable Sound of Right Now. Thank you for coming and speaking with us today, and we are all looking forward to see this amazing film and the discussion to come afterwards. Thank you.
It was because of the way that I am that my mother, you know, like, got rid of me. Because, you know, I'm a lesbian. Like, the first 2 weeks, I was sleeping on the street, literally, like, in a park or the police station.
Immigration. They were looking for my dad. He had to settle down by himself somewhere else. And I had to settle down by myself in a different place.
I've been homeless for a while now, since I've been like 14. Going through several foster homes, you know, DCFS, with some abuse, you know, some sexual, some mental. You lose faith and you lose hope. And sometimes we go down the wrong path and we never get to see the light.
We have 6 freshmen, 8 sophomores, 4 juniors. We have 11 seniors. Each name represents a story, and it represents a person who is going to be awesome someday. So, that's the list.
We're gonna have to do a lottery tonight. Is there anybody who has any place else they can go to tonight other than here? Because we're gonna have to do a lottery and everybody's not gonna be able to get in.
We're only allowed to house 20 people. And I mean, it sucks because it's raining tonight, and as staff, you really don't want to turn anybody away.
Darian.
Darian. That was 18, two more.
Egypt.
Asia.
All right, can I go wild on
you?
I just feel that we misplaced. We trying to find our own home. We trying to build ourselves as an independent person.
I be getting stuck, like I get stuck and don't know what to do.
Ms. Ribeiro introduced me to Shakespeare, which was like life-changing for me. The acting gave me like the opportunities to show them that I was like more than a bad kid.
Like I've been working on finishing my GED because I'm just looking for something more stable because you know I got a son. I'm trying to get my life situated, you know, so I can be there for him.
I was in the first meeting when they came in and I asked the question, so what are your strengths? What are you good at? And when they say, I don't know, nothing. Nobody's ever told me I was good at anything. I'm good at failing. You're like, really? Well, you're good at communicating. You have a beautiful smile. Like, just finding something for them to hold on to in the moment because you're not the piece of shit you feel like right now.
How you gonna change it? How you gonna make your story better? How you gonna write the next chapter of your life?
So I'm Elizabeth Hemmerdinger. I was just asked to introduce the filmmakers and our trusted advisor, Laverne Berry, who's going to do the questioning and conversation. This is Kirsten Kelly and Anne DeMare. Thank you for this wonderful film and for giving all of our minds a home.
I think one of the very first questions that people might want to know is what has happened to the kids that were in this film?
Yeah, so Casey, Rocky, and Anthony have all stayed on the film team and have been traveling with us, and they have become outspoken advocates for the issue of homeless youth. Anthony still has a full-time job with the internship that you saw he started at the end of the film. So he is on board, full benefits. He's continuing to get different levels of certification in technology. He and his girlfriend, who we love, they just had a baby girl. So he's a new father. And he has not been able to make steps in getting custody with his son, who's in a foster care system in Indiana. So that's kind of update on Anthony. Casey has she was recently awarded by the city of Chicago as one of the top 30 under 30 who's advocates for LGBTQ rights. And she has struggled just in terms of trying to find direction or consistent work, but she has really become an outspoken advocate with the film and for LGBTQ, and she also just started her first semester of college. So we're really proud of her for getting to this point. You want to update on Rocky?
Rocky is still at Northeastern Illinois University. It's taking him a little longer to get through than he originally thought because his papers did come through to allow him to work, but financially he tried 1 year working part-time and going to school part-time, and the load was a little much to make happen, so he took some time off to work to save up for the next semester and was able to go to school, you know. So he's trying to piece together his education a little bit back and forth. He still lives with Maria's family. Oh my gosh.
We just tweeted last week, he just got his first apartment. So he and his best friend Joaquin.
Yes.
Who was also in the CPS Shakespeare program. They just moved into their very first apartment together, and he is back in school. He's working full-time and taking part-time classes. Yeah. So a lot has changed, and he has a girlfriend.
Yeah, which we're very happy about. But I think the interesting thing to note, I think when people watch the movie, kind of you leave the young people at a certain point, and that really it isn't a straight line. It's a lot of ups and downs. It's a lot of circular good times and bad times. And they're still struggling with trying to launch as independent people without the kind of support that hopefully many, if not all of us in this room have. And so I think it's interesting to kind of leave them at the film at one point and to have known them for, it's about 2.5 years since we stopped filming, and to kind of see their lives progress. I mean, it took Casey over 3 years from when she graduated from high school to start college. And it's a process for all of the young people. Yeah.
Well, I think that one of the characters in the documentary says something about the young people that actually applies to film. She says, you can't expect to give someone a sandwich and that will solve every issue. And you can't expect to make a documentary film and that will solve all the impact of it. Mm-hmm. So can you talk to us a little bit about how it was you went from having this idea to getting the film made to using the film to talk about this concept?
Okay.
So one of the interesting things I think that has, interesting movements that's really happened in the last 5 years of documentary filmmaking is that this word impact or advocacy, impact campaign, advocacy campaign has really become a hot topic. How do you take your documentary film and make it do really deep, serious work in the world? There's an organization called Good Pitch, and they're out of Britain, and they started in New York, and now it's all over the world, but they accept social justice films, and they do this very theatricalized pitch session for a group of usually 300 to 400 funders, foundations, arts organizations that can help support the film. And basically you're making a trailer and you are pitching it. You have 7 minutes. It's very high pressure. People sit around and talk about you and your film at the table, and they basically commit money right there in the room. And so this has brought a lot of notoriety to this idea of impact, and people now have impact producers. And so we really were committed to diving in deep to that. And while we were finishing our edit, we were started working with an impact producer, planning our impact campaign. And I think Anne will go a little more into this, but the interesting thing is you're still making the film. And so you don't exactly know like the end result of that film. You're going for something, but you know, things change and it morphs along the way. But at the same time, you have to figure out, what do you want to do? You can't do everything in terms of impact, but what do you want to do, and how does that tie with the message that the film is actually conveying? So we were doing those two things in tandem, and they ended up really informing each other as we created, so that we were ready to go with the sort of planning and diving into the impact work right from the get-go of the film coming out.
Yeah, and I think it's interesting. There's a pitfall that we encountered in the edit room where we would have to kind of shut our activist brain off sometimes in order to keep the filmmaking mind open, and vice versa. So it was a tricky balance for a while. One of the big things that you need when you have an impact campaign is you have to understand kind of what is it that you want to do with the film. Some films that have come out in the last few years have had very kind of well-funded, very targeted impact campaigns. There was a film called Bully. I don't know if a lot of you know that film, if any of you saw that film. It was a film about bullying in schools, and they had this desire to get the film in front of a million kids, and they've done that over the course of time. There was a film called Invisible War that came out a few years ago that was about sexual assault in the military, and they wanted a very specific piece of legislation to get passed in Washington. And so they really went at it. With us, we're going after an issue. I mean, homelessness is about many, many issues at once. And so finding that like singular message was really about understanding what the field needed. And so like one of the things that we kept hearing over and over again from the people that we were talking to, the organizations working with young people, was that the number one problem that they had in getting support for homeless kids and in getting access to communities and to individuals to support the kids was the negative stereotype of homeless youth. That really what we had seen was this image of a kind of a strung out runaway sleeping under a bridge, begging for money on the street, and you know, the kind of this negative profiling of what homeless kids were not at all the young people that we were meeting and that people were trying to serve. And so sort of the number one thing we decided we needed to do was make people aware of the crisis in a different way. When we started making this film, that number of the 22,000 kids in the Chicago public schools alone, it blew us away that we would know that there were that many homeless students in a public school system, and nobody was really talking about it in the media. And so, you know, we decided that we needed to, number one, do that, and also to use the film as a tool for organizations to be able to talk to each other around the issue. One of the things we found as we started working with people is that if you ran a homeless shelter for young people, that was the world you knew. And if you were in education, that was the world you knew. And if you worked for the Department of Health and Human Services, that was the world you knew. But the people weren't necessarily talking to each other around the issue. So we knew we wanted to build coalitions to talk about on a community level in our community, what are we going to do? So how did we do that?
Well, and we'll just kind of look at some of these statistics that have happened. This basically happened over the last year. So this is our first year of impact campaign. We're now going into our second year of impact campaign. So those numbers are changing pretty rapidly this fall. But as we scroll through here, one of the things when we were making the film, we were feeling a lot of pressure as filmmakers to... People kept asking us, what's your message going to be? Like, what are you going to tell the audience what they can do when they walk out of the room? Those were the two things. And so we were really coming against this like tremendous pressure of, we didn't have a film that was like Bully, because Bully's message was no bullying. You know, so we didn't have that. And we had a very complex issue. And we were bringing attention to it in a way that was very different. So we really came back to, you know, what we can do is break negative stereotypes. Yeah. And what we can do is ask people to, within yourselves, look at your own stereotypes and your own sort of judgments, right? Because I think we all have them. I mean, it's such a sort of hot topic of blame and in terms of talking about homelessness. And And so, like, how can we open up that discussion? And that in and of itself is taking action. And the other action we ask people to do when you leave is, this is happening everywhere in every school district. And do you know the homeless liaison in your school district, in your community? Because legally, federal law dictates that there is a homeless liaison in every single school district. We didn't know that when we started. No. And so we wanted to bring more attention and more support for schools and teachers, for they were the catch-all, right? And especially in a problem that's often hidden, it was the schools and the teachers who were noticing things in the first place, and how can we bring support? So that's kind of came up with. But it wasn't a catchy marketing phrase.
No, not at all. Not at all. And each community, so the film screened in a, we've now had over 600 live events with various organizations, and the film will be used by all kinds of people. Sometimes a school district will use the film for teacher training in their district. Sometimes homeless organizations will take up the film and use it as a fundraiser. Sometimes you'll end up with, in Washington, there was a philanthropist group that wanted to raise money for the issue. It was their topic this year, and they used the film, and they raised a ton of money and did a huge kind of political campaign around local legislation for homeless youth. So one of the interesting things about the way that we went about our impact campaign was, because we didn't have the one message, we really wanted to listen to other organizations in terms of what can you do with our film? And the answers really surprised us. I think the most interesting thing, or one of the most interesting things that happened, is the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, who are the people who administer the funding from the Runaway and Homeless Youth Act, which is the only federal funding we give to homeless youth in America. They became aware of the film, and we were able to produce this event where we brought together all of the federal agencies at the senior policy level in Washington, D.C. So that's Health and Human Services, Housing and Urban Development, Department of Education, the Office of Juvenile Justice and Delinquency Prevention, and USICH, which is the U.S. Interagency Council on Homelessness. All of their senior policy directors got into a room and watched this film and had this unbelievable conversation about how we can, as a country, do better with youth homelessness. It was kind of a moment that rocked our world, in a sense, because when you start out to make a film, you don't know where it's going to end up, and you don't know how you're going to get there. And that screening happened because we did the seed for that was a tiny screening we did for 11 interns at the Department of Education. And that screening, the people who attended that screening and who put that together, helped plant this seed that allowed us to develop into this federal event. And next month, we're doing HHS, Health and Human Services, is taking the film to each of their 10 district headquarters around the country, and they're doing that same concept of these roundtable policy discussions on the district level in 10 places in the country simultaneously. And it's really exciting because you're watching these three human stories that are so tiny in the frame of things be the source of conversation on a national policy level. And that's what's possible. And we didn't know it was possible. So, I mean, I don't know how to answer the kind of, did you know when you set out? But I think it's about building a team, building coalitions, and pushing and listening a lot to what the world wants from your film, not just what you want for your film, but what the world wants from it.
Well, can we talk a little bit about filmmaker ego for a minute?
What's that?
Because I spent some time with a think tank that has been charged in New York with looking at how documentary films can be used. And amazingly, what they're finding is that the flashy, award-winning, big-budget documentary films are great for general audiences, but they actually don't change policy. So, as much as a smaller, more targeted film. So how do you balance, as a creator, the desire to make a difference and the desire to make a name for yourself?
That's a really good question in terms of the name for yourself. Yeah. That's interesting. I think there's something where there are filmmakers who are not interested in activism. And I think we decided very early on in the kinds of projects we chose and the kinds of careers that we wanted, that we were very interested in that. And so it is a balance of trying to be first and foremost a storyteller, and then also trying to find the stories that, you know, you can turn into a mission that drives you, because you're not making any money at this. So, you know, you are filmmaker, as a documentary filmmaker, you are filmmaker, fundraiser, producer, the person who is pushing the boulder up the hill. Even if you do have a great team, it's really you and your passion that is driving it. Because this, I mean, this project took 5 years. And for the first 2.5, we weren't getting paid at all. And so we would do little jobs here and there, and then that would come in, and we would like, okay, we got a little money here, we can now go do this film. And then once we started having footage, now in order to get any grant, you have to have footage, you have to have a demo. People and foundations seem to want a surety. And there's also this issue with impact now and fundraising, and you know, they want the metrics to prove that this is going to make a difference. And so, you know, you can't provide that ahead of time, and oftentimes when you don't even know what the film is eventually going to be in the end. So you have to really stay true to that kind of filmmaker, storyteller, and keep all the editorial power, because otherwise it starts to become chipped away, and so the actual thing itself becomes weaker. And I think that's where maybe that ego comes in, because you do have to be very strong about borders when you are doing all of those different jobs.
I think you also really have to decide what it is. I think you have to have the personal power to define what success is to you. And I think that's something that we forget about a lot of the time. I think a lot of time we think there's one brass ring out there we're supposed to go for, and that's a certain kind of success. And I think that in reality, your personal idea of what that is different. And I think it's about making peace with what it is that you want to have in your life. You know, I mean, Kirsten alluded to this, but you know, you make almost no money doing this work. I mean, we had a very successful project. The project was funded by MacArthur Foundation. It was backed by Sundance Institute. It got broadcast on Independent Lens, which is kind of the gold standard of where you want to be broadcast if you're this kind of film. And neither one of us got out of this anywhere close to a living wage. But at the same point, you're doing other jobs at the same time, but we have unbelievably wonderful lives. I get to travel around the world and talk about my film, our work, and this is what we do. And so you have to redefine what it is that you're looking for. We would not have that experience if we had made, you know, a glitzy film that had a huge amount of public appeal, sold it to a distributor, and stepped away. We have a very different life, which is one where we're actually in control of the places that we go and the things that we do, and we're working in that way. So it's a different kind of success, and it provides you a different kind of opportunity to talk about your film with a group of high school students in inner city San Diego, half of whom really identify with the kids in the film. That's a whole different kind of success than going to, you know, an opening night party at a film festival and having that experience, which is also terrific, but I think you just have to make a deal with yourself, you know?
Can you talk a little bit more about the fundraising aspect? What that takes, how long it takes, what you need to do with that?
Yeah, I mean, that first demo is really important. And, you know, not only did you kind of, that's your calling card for the project and yourselves as filmmakers, but getting to that point even, you're trying to scramble to figure out how to make the best demo you can with the least amount of money so that then you can really start to get more, you know, funding and support. And you really, it's, people give money to people. And so it really is finding your team and your people and the people who believe in you and the mission of the project, and you create a family for the project. You really do. And you know, in collaborating and involving people, and you know, there's certain really large grants that are specifically for documentary filmmaking, like the MacArthur grant. But that's not all your money. Like that's, I mean, when we got the MacArthur grant, that was half our budget. So we knew that we could do that. And we had already gotten a very, very small Sundance grant. And so that opens doors. You start putting a little Sundance name on there and you start putting MacArthur. And then people will take your phone call. But it is, you are really scrambling. Like, there was a point where we had completely run out of funds and we were going just to have to stop the edit. What we learned, we co-produced this film with Cartemquin Films, who did Hoop Dreams and The Interrupters. You know, they've been doing these films for 50, it's now their 50th anniversary. And, you know, they were really like, okay, helped us strategize and said, all right, this is an emergency funding opportunity. Yeah. And so, you know, right away we went to people and said, we've had these talks before, but now we're in an emergency. We will have to stop and we will not be able to finish this film. And that was a very powerful strategy. Yeah. And we, you know, got immediately raised about $50,000 to keep going.
Yeah.
But you never had all the money all at once.
No, there's a lot of faith that goes into this because you have to be moving forward before you have the funds to do it. And then you have to deliver on it because you've promised this forward. So it's a, and the other issue about the fundraising, that has to do with social impact, is all your funders want to know what you're going to do down the line, as Kirsten was saying. So you're kind of juggling this, I think we can take this film, which isn't finished yet, and do these things with it that we don't have the open doors to do yet. And we think we can raise the money to do that, even though we haven't raised the money to make the film yet. So you operate on a lot of faith to move forward. And that's what that feeling of like pushing the boulder over the hill is, because ultimately Kirsten and I would have these, you know, these late night conversations of, okay, how are we going to make this happen? And the only thing we can do right now is make this little piece of it happen. And you just have to keep moving forward. So
I wanted to make sure that if anybody in the audience had a question before the evening ends?
Was exactly the next thing I was going to do.
Oh, you were going to do that?
Yes. We do a lot of documentary films, so we can say a lot about them, but it's really important to, after seeing the film and hearing a bit from the filmmakers, to know whether or not you have specific questions that you'd like to ask.
Hi, my name is Grace. I was wondering, how do you balance the amount of statistics to the amount of like personality you put in? Because you didn't have many, which I liked, but I felt like there were like the statistics around LGBT youth that are homeless. I've worked in a lot of I'm from San Diego actually. I've worked in the center, which is an LGBT center, and so a lot of homeless youth there are LGBT. So I was just wondering of like how many statistics you put in. And
it's a really good question. I think that when we first had the first cut of the film, we had a lot more statistics in it than there are now. I think especially if you're shooting while you're editing and you're trying to find your story, you are writing a lot of that on the screen until you can find out how you, but what we discovered is as we started to pare back the film, you know, you start with a cut that's 3 hours long, you know, and you work it, you carve the marble away, as it were, to find what the structure underneath. We really found that the less voice we had and the more voice we were able to give to the young people themselves, the better. It's interesting, the question about the LGBTQ statistic is really huge. So around 40% of homeless youth identify as gay, lesbian, transgender, bisexual, and it's disproportionate to the general population. And because of that, and because of the work that we were doing with the True Colors Fund, which is Cyndi Lauper's foundation specifically for that purpose, we actually cut a separate film, a little 15-minute film that really focuses on that part of the equation that's being used by organizations for education in that area. So it's that thing of like you listen to what the story is. And for the story that we were telling with the three young people, we didn't feel a need to put that statistic out. We really only wanted to like open up the size of the problem, the 22,000 kids, and let everything else kind of come out of the general storytelling. But it is a huge part of the equation. You know,
I would just also say that who we are as filmmakers, I don't feel like I'm a journalist.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm a storyteller, and the stories I'm interested in are the human journey stories. And so even though this is a social justice film, I see it still as a human journey film, and that this is three stories that surround this complex problem that we have. So I also think I don't often, you know, unless there's a really powerful statistic like the 22,000, I think, which was part of our journey of discovery that hit us over the head and we were like enraged. That's why that is in there, because it's this thing. It's like, we want you to feel our rage in a way.
Hi, I'm Kelsey. How did you find Casey, Anthony, and Rocky specifically, and how did you build trust with them?
That's a really good question.
Yeah. Rocky and Maria actually were part of a Shakespeare program that I was, you saw a little bit of me in there working with them on Hamlet. So I had been working with Rocky, I had been working with Maria for about 2 years and Rocky for about a year and a half when Maria came to me and said, you should talk to Rocky because he's in some serious trouble with, you know, his dad. And so it just ended up that they ended up taking him in and we started filming very slowly, and because we wanted to be sensitive around, you know, this big transition that had happened in Rocky's life. And so that was sort of, the trust was built pretty fast because there was already an existing relationship.
And, you know, we worked actually with about a dozen young people over the course of the 5 years. And because we're not social workers and also because we're not necessarily journalists, we were really fortunate that what we did was we started working with organizations that were working with this population, and we got really good guides into communities. So Dr. Ozella Barnes at Teen Living Program, who you see briefly in the film, really helped us to forge the relationships with Casey and Anthony, because both Casey and Anthony were at Teen Living Program's house. There were other programs that we worked with, and at the Night Ministry, Jake at the Crib really helped us to establish relationships with the street kids there. So we asked for help is how we did it. You know, we knew that you can't kind of walk up to a homeless young person on the street and say, here's a camera, tell me your story. And we spent a tremendous amount of time with the young people without the camera being there. And I think that was a big part of it, is like when we committed to kind of an interest in them as human beings. And the camera, it was very organic, you know, those relationships and how they built. And there were young people that we worked with for whom working with us was no longer a good thing, where, you know, we were treading in territory where they weren't necessarily comfortable telling their story, where we couldn't kind of navigate the trust issues as well. And obviously these are young people who are dealing with a tremendous amount of trauma in many cases. They come out of really difficult backgrounds, and they're going through transitions lightning pace in their lives. So it's a process, you know?
And I would say we early on committed to ourselves that we wanted to take a lot of time with the story, because of, you know, what we were seeing was a lot of very, you know, quick to stereotype, quick to identify. You know, part of the trust issue with these kids was there was a lot of, you know, sort of bad practices in terms of people come up and saying, like, you know, I've got 10 minutes, tell me your story, and they put the worst parts of their story into the little article on the thing. So we just really wanted to commit to take time.
Yeah. And the other thing that relates to that is that we didn't want to make a story about how much it sucks to be homeless. What we want, because we, what we wanted to do is make a film about, okay, you're in this situation, how do we really help people move out of it? So we wanted to make a film about their agency in it instead of their being, you know, the victims of their circumstance. And I think they all really appreciated that in the way that we were communicating with them, because we wanted to be there for those moments where they were moving forward. And it's difficult because in a lot of those moments, we would be the only adult there. There would be these moments which were super important, like graduations, really big moments where they didn't have, where we were the adult support in the room. And that was very sobering for us, you know?
What personal lessons do you feel you have learned from working with these youth and telling their stories?
That's a great question.
I have just a really simple anecdotal one, which is that in my story of my own life, you know, everyone has their story. I left home when I was very young, and I had this image that my family had not been very supportive of me. And I have to say that making this film, I understood the gifts that they gave me. I always knew I was smart. I always knew I could do anything I set my mind to. I always knew I was worthy of being loved. And so no matter what my personal background was, what I realized was my parents gave me an awful lot, because the young people that I was dealing with, that we were dealing with, never had any of those things. So on a really personal level, it made me rewrite my own story for myself and be very grateful for what my parents gave me.
I think I really, you know, really learned just how much effort it takes to move the next step forward. Because I think, you know, certainly in the US, we are still very much caught in this dialogue of pull up your bootstraps and work hard and you're going to get ahead. And I don't think that that's true anymore. I think those are great work ethics to have in mind, but that the communities that we've been working with and the kids that we've been working with, you know, have really been dealt a hand of cards, that they by themselves as super, super young people are having to figure their way out of this chaos and trauma. And there is a disadvantage, and many are striving through that to get above it, but it is not a simple journey, and the kids who don't take that road doesn't mean they're lazy, and it doesn't mean they're dumb. And I think what I really, even when we're going out and talking about the film, you know, that's really one of the things I learned from them, and I want to pass that on as we take the film out.
I have a question. Often being the lawyer on these documentaries, as well as sometimes some other roles, there's a lot of things that make me not sleep at night. How did you deal with the ethical issues around being in very sensitive situations with kids that in some cases were underage?
I think very early on, we decided we were human beings first and filmmakers second. And that, you know, in no way did we want to exploit these kids and their sort of traumatic situations. And so that's really a navigation through that. And a lot of talking to other filmmakers, other activists, to really help guide you. There is not, you know, as Anne says, the guide we came up with in terms of filming was that we never wanted it to feel transactional, where you felt like someone was working with you or telling you their story or establishing a relationship in order to get something. And, you know, not that we didn't make a hard and fast rule about, I mean, if someone was hungry that we've been having a relationship with, we were going to feed them, and if we're going to give rides to people, and, you know, whatever we could do to kind of make, without changing their story, but supporting them in particular moments when we were often the only people to show up was, you know, it was a navigation.
Yeah, and there's also something very humbling when you realize that you actually can't come in and save someone. You know, I think that, you know, what you realize is that all you can do is, and it becomes a little more complex because now we don't film anymore. We now have relationships with these young people that are not necessarily governed by the fact that we have to have a formality around the filming. And so, but what you realize is that you can support someone to move forward on their own, but you can't actually move them forward. You can support someone in a challenge in their life and be there and be present for them and be witness for them, but you yourself, you know, I realized very early on that as much as I would have loved to have taken certain young people into my, under my motherly like wings and save their themselves from their situation, they actually need to be, they didn't need to be saved from themselves. What they need to do is to build their own life. And I could help support them in that in whatever way I could. I don't know, does that make sense? I mean, and it was very humbling because I think we like to think that we can, if we can identify a problem, we can go in and we can solve it. And I think one of the things about the film that I'm really proud of is that I feel like we try to be witness to a problem in a way that allows people, invites people to look at it, but it doesn't say what we need to do is X, Y, Z, and we're going to prescribe how you're supposed to behave, and we've now fixed the issue of youth homelessness if only people would, you know, listen to us. We've raised the question for people to wrestle with themselves and to understand how do you support it in your own community and with the people that you know.
I mean, one of the things that we found funny after a while, which is very bizarre, is that, you know, while we were filming all these things, you would just hear these, you know, the mayor of Chicago and his, you know, new campaign to end homelessness by, or, I mean, these were going on, it's a catchy phrase, right? And everybody wants it to happen, but it never does. Yeah. So it's an interesting thing of, like, you know, looking back at that thing, someone asked about marketing, like where was the conversations about marketing in the process? And I think that's, you know, that's a very marketing thing, a very messagey thing that's easy to quickly glob onto, but then, you know, you have such a complex issue, and to really be honest with this issue, you can't end it.
No.
So you have to figure out how to support this as part of continued society.
Yeah.
In better and better ways, work better and harder at it, but you can't end it.
Yeah.
So, do you have any last takeaways for both the filmmakers and the other folks who are here that are interested in the social justice aspect of the film?
I think that as filmmakers, you have to tell the film that opens to you and be curious about the things that you're curious about as an individual. I think you always tell a better story if it's something that drives you. I always, you know, I want to make films that I would like to watch. And I think that the more you can identify both with your subject and with your audience, the stronger opportunity you have to actually make a difference, you know.
And I mean, it would be for me making that family around your project. I mean, bringing the people that you respect and who can support you as a cheerleader, or who can give you honest feedback, or can help you get a connection. I mean, you cannot do these things alone. And the sooner in a project, I think, that you find, you know, your tribe and bring them close and build that trust internally, the better you're going to be able to push that boulder up the mountain, because, you know, you have your own personal trust network in place to do an impossible thing.
Anything else from there? Well then, please feel free if you have any questions that you want to ask of the filmmakers privately, please just come on up, and thank you so much for being here.
And we'll
thank
also
you.
Be here tomorrow talking about our future projects, which are around the bend. So if you're interested, please show up again tomorrow night and we'll talk about very different things.